The first time I discovered Tintin, I was reading a review in a French magazine on Raiders of the Lost Ark. This was in 1981 when the film opened, and I took a little high school French, and I can barely read French, but this word kept coming up, which I thought was a French word, you know, T-I-N, T-I-N, all the way through this review. It kept saying Tintin this, Tintin that, just everywhere across the pages was Tintin. I don't know, you know, I thought maybe it was a French word. You know, maybe it meant, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark is a great movie. it stood for something about my movie. Well, in fact, it didn't stand for anything about my movie. It was kind of saying that Raiders was almost like a beloved title and series of books by the great author and artist Hergé called The Adventures of Tintin. And that's how I first came into contact with those books.
Come on! Smelly, after it!
The Tintin books were the first books that I ever read, really, when I was a kid. They were my introduction to the world of reading. And obviously, like any comic, it's a great way for, you know, a young person, a kid, to get used to the idea that you've got to read words as you grow older. And I remember very distinctly sitting down and reading my first Tintin book, which was The Black Island, and really loving it. In some respects, The Black Island is still one of my favourite Tintin books. But I also grew up at a period when the books hadn't been fully translated into English yet. But I'd sit in the library and read these French books, trying to understand the story and the plot.
Prisoners of the Sun was the first book I got hold of, all written in French. But I understood the story without really understanding enough French to read every frame. Every single panel told a story in cinematic terms, including color palette, composition, figures in action. Very expressive actions, the way Hergé would pose his characters, almost like he was trying to squeeze out 24 frames in a single frame and succeeding. That was, I think, the genius of Hergé. It was a movie. And I started reading all the books and became instantly a fan.
When Sir Francis was rescued and returned home, he was convinced his name had been cursed.
The beauty with the Tintin stories is that you can approach them on different levels. They function as exciting adventure stories with action and, you know, for a young kid, it certainly stimulates your imagination. But as you grow older, you realize that there's actually some subtext behind the stories.
Do you understand? You care about something, you fight for it.
And there's great character and slapstick comedy as well. But I think as a kid, what I loved was the adventure. And I also loved the fact that they were not superhero orientated or science fiction. The Tintin books are very much based on reality without any magical embellishment. It's just the world that you and I live in. And the adventures that Tintin gets himself into when you're young, you can easily imagine that they could be your adventures as well. And that is one of the secrets of why they're so appealing, I think.
What else have you found out?
What is there to find?
That depends what you're looking for.
I'm looking for answers.
I only read the books and just based on that, wanted to see if Hergé would consider letting me try to adapt the books into a motion picture or a series of motion pictures. And so I was able to contact Hergé. I was shooting the sequel to Raiders of the Lost Ark, The Temple of Doom, in 1983. When I made contact with Hergé by phone, had a great chance to talk to him. And then tragically, in those several weeks that transpired, Hergé died. He passed away. And I got a call about a month later from Fanny, his widow, who said, Hergé really wanted to meet you and really wanted to talk to you about Tintin, and I would like now to invite you to the studio to meet us and see his work. So Kathy Kennedy and I came to Belgium and we toured the studio and saw his work.
Our first reaction was, there's no question this could be a movie, but the real challenge is, how do you do this and not have it just look like Indiana Jones with a boy?
I was able to get the rights and took a really healthy pass at developing scripts, and it wasn't quite there yet as a motion picture. And then 2 decades passed.
And it wasn't until many, many years later that Steven said, I know how we could do Tintin.
I think that's good to have that. That's really, really good. It gives me a lot of ideas to what we can do. I'd always known that Tintin and I were destined for some kind of collaboration. So I was first of all going to shoot the movie live action. but it would be a very stylized movie because I wanted the characters to look very much like the Hergé characters. And I was a little worried that I was going to have to do a lot of prosthetic makeup to really achieve a look that would resemble who these characters are in the panels of all of the books. But I always also knew that if it was going to be a live-action movie, there'd be no way I could get a performance of the Snowy unless Snowy was a digital animated creation. So I wanted to do a test, and I went to Peter Jackson's company, Weta.
He wanted to talk to us about doing computer-generated Snowy for him because we'd done Lord of the Rings, and I think we were working on King Kong at the time, and he liked the CGI work that we were doing down here in New Zealand.
And I called Peter on the phone, and I said, Peter, I'm thinking about making Tintin live-action. I'd like to do a test by seeing what it would look like to put Snowy, a digital Snowy, into a live-action scene. Peter said, okay, leave it to my boys and girls at Weta. And then a couple months later, we got the results back. A 35mm film showed up here at Amblin, and we put it up on the screen, and there was an amazingly realistically rendered Snowy.
Stop that.
But next to Snowy, there was a live-action Captain Haddock.
It's my turn.
In full regalia, and it was Peter Jackson himself playing Captain Haddock. He had put himself in the test.
Ever since I was a kid, when I grew a beard at the age of 7, kids at school used to tease me and call me Haddock. I had them make a costume for me with the blue jumper and the hat. And I thought I looked quite similar to Captain Haddock, I have to say.
Takes that you wouldn't have to use much film stock.
And I sent that to Stephen, and we spoke to each other, and he enjoyed the test.
I said, Peter, you should play Captain Haddock. If I succeed in making this a live-action movie, you got to be in my movie and play Captain Haddock. You were good. You were really good. We had a great laugh about it. And then some time passed, and I decided that really the best way to honor Hergé and come as close to his palette and his portraiture as possible was to do the movie in the new performance capture technology, and thought that would be the best way to tell the story.
Of course, I've seen you in the newspaper. You're a reporter?
This was the point that performance capture was beginning to establish itself. And the reason why performance capture is very attractive is that it allows us to turn the two-dimensional illustrations that Hergé drew into three-dimensional figures that still look very much as if he designed them himself.
And then I told Peter I'd like to make the picture with Weta doing the entire movie. Performance capture, meaning the entire movie animated. And would you be interested, Peter, if I make more than one movie, I'll direct the first one, you'll direct the second one, and maybe, if you've got time, we can produce the whole series. And Peter immediately said, if you were here right now, you would see over my shoulder is the entire series of Hergé books. So he was a fan from his childhood, unlike me. When I was a fan from 1981, he was a fan much longer. And we decided to collaborate on this together.
He just takes
and
the drop.
And perhaps he has to puppeteer the drop around so that
drop
it doesn't
around the finger. And then he can get it right to the tongue, because the glass would, it would dissipate the glass.
Yeah. Well, I think Peter represents the audience internationally that already knows Tintin. And I represent the audience in Canada, in America, that don't know Tintin. And so I think we both represent both sides of that coin.
How's your thirst for adventure?
That young man, what's his name?
Him? Everybody knows him. That's Tintin.
The name is Tintin, all right? And the sound un doesn't exist in English. So they say Tintin.
Tintin?
But it doesn't matter. We're talking about the same character. And Tintin or Tintin, it's the universe of Hergé that is important.
I have to say, your face is familiar. Have I drawn you before?
Occasionally.
Of course, I've seen you in the newspaper. You are a reporter?
I'm a journalist.
Well, we don't really know how Tintin got his name. Hergé himself couldn't explain it. I remember asking him, and he wasn't quite sure himself. He said he liked the alliteration, the Tintin, the Tintin. And it's very important to keep Tintin all in one word. Some people try and split it, which is a very bad mistake. It's like calling the Thompsons twins when they're not.
There. I believe I have captured something of your likeness.
Ah. Not bad. What do you think, Snowy?
I think Tintin is absolutely ageless. He is ageless in the sense that during the 50 years that Tintin was developed and his stories were published by Hergé, he never grew old. The world around him changed, but he himself is remaining timeless, which is wonderful. I mean, mean, Tintin as an old man just wouldn't be the same thing at all.
Let the kid name his price.
When Hergé started Tintin in 1929, he meant him to be 15, which was the age of his younger brother, Paul. So I think he was meant to be in that sort of, you know, 15 to 20 bracket. That's how he saw him, I think.
Where is that magnifying glass?
I think even before I knew what it was, I knew what he looked like. There's something about Hergé's drawing and his artwork that it leaves an imprint on you. It's unforgettable. And then with that knowledge, with that iconic imagery in my head, I watched the animated television series on Channel 4 as a kid in England.
I remember the cartoon being on TV because I remember the beginning, the guy went, Hergé's Adventures of Tintin. And he has that incredible quiff, which is, you know, symbolic of moving forwards and upwards. And I think he's exactly that. He's the kind of kid that doesn't take no for an answer.
Well, the quiff came about when he was doing that first adventure, which sends him to the Soviet Union. If you look at the early pages, the hairstyle is rather nondescript. I mean, it's not very tidy. It could be anything. But then there's that marvellous moment when he's escaping from the police in a Mercedes open tourer, and the car goes whoosh, and this indeterminate hairstyle goes into a quiff. In the drawing, that's how it happened as he drew it. And that was the hairstyle which stuck. And that and the plus four trousers were the things which became a hallmark of Tintin.
Where have you been? Huh? Chasing cats again?
And in introducing Tintin, we decided to do what Hergé did, which is to not explain his backstory. Hergé never gave us information about Tintin's family, his parents. But that doesn't matter because I think there's a sense of mystery. There's an enigma to Tintin, which is fun. You know, as a kid, I used to wonder what had happened to his family and why didn't he have a mum and dad and how could he be a reporter when he's so young and am I going to have to get a job when I'm that young? I mean, when you're a kid, you're using Tintin as a role model and thinking he's famous, he's had adventures, he solves crime. That's what we're doing in the movie. That's our Tintin, and we're not explaining anything that Hergé didn't explain because we don't feel that we need to.
We're going to the one place that could have the answer.
It's a journey to discovery, with a lot of other characters trying to cut that discovery short by any lethal means available to them.
Get the TNT.
Part of it is a mystery. Part of it is a gumshoe detective genre story, a little noirish from time to time. Some of it is just absolute, unapologetic, shameless adventure. Globetrotting, like Indiana Jones, you know, runs all over the world. Tintin, the same thing. Searching mysteries and stories and superstitions.
You do know what you're doing, eh, Tintin?
Relax! I interviewed a pilot once!
Hergé himself was not a traveller while he was writing these wonderful Tintin books. But as everyone knows, they were so accurate because he had done his research so thoroughly. I mean, each country he sent Tintin to, he would really read everything about the country, have a huge amount of source information on the subject, so that when Tintin went there, it really was like that country. The amazing thing is that he was a journalist at heart, and each adventure from 1929 onwards reflected current affairs in a particular part of the world where Tintin was sent. And there was an educational reason for that, because this was meant for young readers. It was meant to educate them about parts of the world they wouldn't know about and what was happening. The most amazing thing is that some adventures actually anticipate things which were happening. I mean, the classic example is the Moon Adventure, which was completed in 1953, 16 years before Armstrong took those first steps which Tintin had taken before.
Snowy, look at this.
It's not that Tintin gets into trouble, it's that trouble finds Tintin and Snowy and anyone who accomplices them.
I don't think you realize this, but you're about to walk into a whole mess of danger.
What kind of danger?
Our story starts instantly. Maybe less than 30 seconds after you meet Tintin, he already becomes interested in a model boat in a glass case for sale called the Unicorn.
Isn't she a beauty?
That's a very unique specimen, that is.
And he doesn't buy it because he's a model collector.
I'll give you a pound.
Done!
He just sees this incredible model that captures his imagination, lights up his eyes, and Snowy's. And the second he buys that model, he has entered a world of adventure like nothing he's ever experienced, except probably in the book that preceded this one.
Why so many questions?
It's my job.
Tintin is very driven. He's a very driven character. He will get to the bottom of it no matter what. He will complete the code. He will crack it. And he always wins.
Aha!
And I think as a kid, I always projected everything onto him. And therefore, you know, he was my hero.
We've lost the scroll. But we haven't lost the story.
At the time that Stephen was talking to us about the test for Snowy, he sent me a couple of scripts. And one of them was The Crab with the Golden Claws, and the other one was Secret of the Unicorn. And so I looked at the scripts, and we started to throw ideas backwards and forwards, and it seemed as if the story of The Crab with the Golden Claws wasn't really robust enough to really sustain a feature film. But what that story has, which is critical, is the first meeting of Tintin and Haddock.
A giant rat of Sumatra!
Captain Haddock arrives in 1940. There's a very good reason for him arriving, because this had gone on too long, just Tintin and Snowy, and Hergé felt that there needed to be some character development.
Excellent.
And so he thought it was important to have this alter ego, so he introduced Haddock. And whenever we have surveys on the most popular characters in Tintin, who is the most popular character? Not Tintin, Captain Haddock.
Peter and I immediately agreed that Captain Haddock should have his introduction in whatever the first Tintin movie is.
Tintin, by the way.
Haddock. Archibald Haddock.
And then the great adventure that Peter and I talked about mostly was Red Rackham's Treasure and The Secret of the Unicorn, which is sort of a double truck book. And so we thought we would use elements from Crab of the Golden Claws with the Caribou Jean.
I want this on the starboard side!
And the introduction of Haddock.
You're the captain!
Of course I'm not captain. Who else could I be?
And then collapsed both a section of that with a lot of The Secret of the Unicorn. And we had our movie. And we did all this with the blessing of Fanny and the estate of Hergé, because we didn't make a move without them.
What secret? The location to one of the greatest sunken treasures in all history.
The Wreck of the Unicorn.
Peter Jackson got in touch with me, I think in 2005, and he mentioned to me, said, we might be doing Tintin. I wasn't really available at the time because I was about to start making a movie. But I did recommend some other people, one of whom was Stephen Moffat, because Peter was a big fan of the new Doctor Who series, and Stephen Moffat was one of the writers on that.
Generally speaking, I turned down movies, but, you know, obviously it was Steven Spielberg and Peter Jackson, and I was thinking, okay, that's, you know, I'll be a bold man just to turn that down. So I said, well, what is it? And he said, it's Tintin. And I thought, well, that's actually quite exciting. I used to love Tintin. So I had a look at a few of the books, and I thought, well, you know, I could see that I could maybe help with it. I think I could do something with it.
And Stephen Moffat did an amazing job of merging The Secret of the Unicorn and The Crab with the Golden Claws. But Stephen Moffat had to leave to go and become a producer on Doctor Who. And Peter Jackson and Steven Spielberg were looking for someone to take the reins. And they came to Edgar Wright. And I was writing with Edgar at that time. And Edgar knew that I was a huge, very passionate Tintin fan. So Edgar sort of brought me on board to write with him.
It was the funniest thing of two men in their 30s sitting around going, come on, Snowy. And just sitting around doing the different voices all the time.
Great snakes!
Part of me wanted to play Tintin. And then we got the call. It was probably one of the most fun times I've ever had writing, because it was like being the star of our own Tintin radio play.
Of course!
Blistering blue barnacles!
This may sound crazy, but I've got a plan.
Thundering typhoons.
What Steven Spielberg did, and Peter Jackson and Kathy Kennedy, obviously, it was to go and look for strong actors who could do the job, but also were going to bring their skills to the film.
The idea of building an iconic character like Tintin is this almost very simple round face, but the idea of coming up with that little tuft of hair to make him instantly recognizable, it captured the zeitgeist. It entered into an art form that is now something that maybe even Hergé had probably never even dreamt of while he was alive.
Tintin's an interesting challenge in casting Tintin, because you want somebody who has a certain agelessness, but someone who's not a child, because you can't make him too young. He can look after himself on these adventures, and he can look after himself in a car chase, or he knows how to fly a plane. I mean, there has to be a certain world knowledge that Tintin has whilst remaining youthful. And it didn't take us too long to think of Jamie Bell. I mean, I was lucky enough to work with Jamie on King Kong.
I was always impressed by Billy Elliot and what Jamie Bell did in that movie. That performance was astonishing to me. Not just the subtlety of his acting, but the tremendous physical performance he gave. So Peter and I both came up with the idea that Jamie Bell would be the ideal Tintin.
He leaps, he jumps, he fights, he gets involved in all sorts of terrific stunts, and Jamie is a very physical actor. And so we don't have to use stunt people very often. Jamie's able to do it single-handedly. So finding Tintin was a big relief for us.
If I'd have known that, you know, as a boy watching this on Sunday mornings, you know, with my face this close to the screen and loving everything about Tintin, then jump forward and be playing this character every day that they put this Tintin thing on with this little piece of Velcro so the reference cameras can identify us, it's a big weight. It's a big weight for me. It feels like an enormous responsibility. He's loved by so many. It's an amazing opportunity, and I'm so lucky to have this chance.
Snowy, you haven't seen the, where is it?
What's fantastic about Tintin is that he doesn't always get it right. And often it's Snowy who actually gets it right.
Snowy doesn't talk or think in a language, which is what the books show. There's thought bubbles and dialogue snippets throughout the books that express how Snowy is thinking. And I think they had to do that because of the limitation of the art form. With a movie, because Snowy's moving and expressing himself constantly, Peter and I didn't feel that we really had a need to give a sort of tutorial to an audience by allowing this to be a talking dog, which, you know, if there's any reality to Tintin at all, it's that the dog doesn't talk. And we felt that was important.
He's a dog, but he does a lot more than just, you know, trot round after Tintin by his ankles. He gets involved in the plots. He sometimes has a significant role to play in scenes.
Snowy, what have you done?
There's moments in the film where something that Snowy does is absolutely the catalyst for the film, the plot going ahead.
I'd stand back if I were you.
Captain Haddock is a character who has fallen from grace, if in fact there ever was a grace note anywhere in his life. He's a unrepentant drinker who has used the bottle to escape the fact that his forefathers were heroic, like the great Sir Francis Haddock, a kind of pirate hunter. He would go around retrieving the loot that pirates would take. And so he has a lot of nobility and a lot of honor in his ancestry, but it has not trickled down successfully to the current Haddock line.
On a bottle of rum rolling on the deck, and he opens it up. To his lips, and
then he stops.
I think the fact that Herite decided that Haddock has a drinking problem.
Have we here?
It's not something you see in movies that you would consider family films, but it's treated in a way that Tintin absolutely does not accept the way Haddock lives his life.
I can smell it on you.
And yet he recognizes that that's who he is, and he works very hard to try to get Haddock to see that there is a better way to live his life, and that it's important that he stop drinking and that it's not good for him. And so that's a kind of line of storytelling that runs throughout the entire movie.
Just a wee tipple. A toast.
I think Tintin brings a lot of value to Captain Haddock's life, giving Captain Haddock a chance to redeem himself. And Captain Haddock brings many lessons to Tintin's life that Tintin never expected to learn from anyone, let alone this sort of old reprobate sea captain.
I swear, as the last of the Haddocks, that I will get that boat before Saccharin does.
To Bagar.
I think I just one day said, you know, we ought to hire Andy Serkis to play Captain Haddock. He's done so well for you, Peter, you know, King Kong and Gollum, and he knows the medium better than any human being alive today, and he's funny, and he's a wonderful actor.
Come on, then. Empty.
And everybody instantly jumped on that, and he became Captain Haddock overnight.
I'm Tintin, by the way.
Haddock, Archibald Haddock. There's a longboat on deck. Follow me.
Hang on a second.
Did you say Haddock?
I like to do quite a lot of research. So, I mean, particularly for Captain Haddock, you know, I wanted to find out a lot about the maritime side of things and his seamanship. Because actually, I mean, Captain Haddock is a master seaman. He is brilliant at his job. It's only he's an alcoholic and has foibles and is fallible, like most of humanity. And I think that's what's appealing about the character.
I don't remember anything about anything.
We've decided to play Haddock with a Scottish accent.
Memory is not what it used to be.
And what did it used to be?
I've forgotten.
It was seemed appropriate, you know, in the tests that we did. Sat around and we talked about the character and that he should have kind of the rawness and kind of emotional availability of a more Celtic kind of feel.
Put us both out of our misery.
Captain Haddock was a very crucial role, and to tell you the truth, I mean, I couldn't think of anybody other than Andy Serkis.
What do you want? Why are you following us?
Thompson and Thompson are just, I think, in the great tradition of the silent movie stars, such as Laurel and Hardy and Charlie Chaplin. We always kind of see them as being two sort of Oliver Hardys in a way, and they're very fastidious, but ultimately bumbling.
We're completely clueless.
They work for the International Police Service and consider themselves to be the greatest detectives.
Yeah.
And clearly are the worst.
Haven't you heard? There's a pickpocket about.
People call them the Thompson twins, but, I mean, they're not. They're not twins at all. They just happen to be two detectives called Thompson and Thompson, and they happen to look identical, but that's just a coincidence.
Tintin?
Gentlemen?
They are not twins. One spells his name with a P in the middle, Thompson.
No, Thompson. This is Thompson without a P, as in psychic. No. It's Thompson with a P, as in psychology.
One has a moustache which twirls a bit. The other comes down straight, so they are slightly different.
Great Scotland Yard! That's extraordinary.
Peter and I wanted to cast a team to play Thompson and Thompson. We didn't want to cast two actors who didn't know each other, so we were looking for kind of writing teams, comedy teams, and it was suggested to us
of using Nick Frost and Simon Pegg, who have worked together on a number of films.
I think it was even Peter Jackson who came up with the idea.
This was actually Stephen's idea.
So we went for them.
They immediately bring that kind of partnership, that Laurel and Hardy type of quality to this relationship. Now, obviously, Simon and Nick look completely different to each other, but that's where the beauty of performance capture comes. And, you know, it's our job to make them look identical.
We were friends first and foremost for a long time, and I think we share a certain mindset where we can, and I think that's helped us to be Thompson and Thompson, where we know what the other's going to do.
A light-fingered fiend has the city in his grip. The commissioner personally assigned us to the case.
If you're playing twins, even though they're not twins, it's really helped us, I think.
Saccharin?
That's Mr. Saccharin to you.
The villain is a very difficult aspect of the story. We've taken a little bit of a liberty from what Heger did, and we've taken a secondary character from The Secret of the Unicorn, and we've actually promoted him to the status of principal villain. We wanted somebody interesting to play that role who would really surprise us and not give us a character that we'd be expecting. And so we really thought hard who this could be, and it was Stephen came up with the idea of Daniel Craig.
I heard on the grapevine that he was making the film and that he started collaborating with Peter on it. So he called me up and said, would I do it? And I thought about it and said yes. Simple as that.
Welcome to Marlin Spike Hall.
Daniel sort of plays what I like to call a champagne villain. He's crude when he has to be, but he sort of has this mock elegance.
After you.
And Daniel and I are friends, and we've worked together before. And I just saw him as Saccharin.
I based him on that sort of English tradition of playing bad guys and try to make it my own.
You need to think about exactly how useful you are to me.
Having read the books, I kind of had a good sort of idea of what the tone should be and how far to go, and Stephen just encouraged me just to sort of push it as far as I could possibly go, which was great fun.
Excuse us.
There is this wonderful female character, which is Bianca Castafore, who doesn't actually appear in The Secret of the Unicorn, but does appear in a lot of other Tintin stories. So we decided to actually include her in our story because she actually does something very significant for our plot. And so she's a very iconic character who turns out to be one of the banes of Haddock's existence. He runs screaming from the room whenever she starts singing.
My ears.
She ends up in the movie in a way that is actually quite delightful.
I am playing Omar Ben Salad, and I love this character because
I use my roots and my country. I'm born in Morocco, and I use my Moroccan accent.
Now, this I like, so maybe you're still walking as you're saying this.
We are blessed with your presence.
When I speak like this, it's all my childhood that's coming back, and I love it.
When Gad started working, it was so instant as to why he was here, because he was that character.
Arrest him! Wait. The ugly one!
No, wait!
Hey, me!
I don't think Americans understand how big and important is Tintin for the French, and not only French, for Europeans. For example, I was a few days ago in Belgium to promote a movie. And I was promoting this movie, my movie, but during the press conference, the only thing that the people would love to know and want to know was what's going on with Tintin and Spielberg, and what are you going to do with Tintin? Because for them, it's their childhood, it's their life. Tintin is so big for them. So talk to us about Tintin.
And beyond that, the casting's been a combination of using actors that either Stephen or I have had experience with before, or we, in some of the smaller roles, we did auditions like we normally do and found actors to play the parts.
I play one of the bad guys shooting at them from a seaplane. It was a lot of fun. I had one day's work, but for me, I as I said to Stephen and Peter, I said, this is pure joy for me.
To a certain extent, you're blinded by the technology when you first walk in. You can't quite see how on earth with this camera here and with these chicken wire props, and you can't quite work out how it's going to happen. And actually, the whole thing is very relaxed and very easy.
When you see the screen at the back and you actually see your cartoon character in real time, I mean, that's the thing that blew my mind, really, because, you know, when you move, it moves.
It's brilliant to play a bad guy and to play someone that doesn't look like me. I mean, it's strange that the whole motion capture thing, I'm playing this quite a beefy, butch kind of guy. And I'm not a beefy, butch type of guy, so it's good to play this proper thug.
The beauty of this is it's like doing animation in a scuba diving suit, because they can morph your shape, make you into anything.
This way, sir.
So vocally, if you can change sufficiently, then you can play a whole number of roles.
10 years I've been flogging bric-a-brac, and I missed name your price by one bleating minute.
I think the performance capture medium requires a little more projection of one's feelings. You know, I think a performance has to be not forced, but extended a little stronger than normal. Not that subtleties don't exactly read, but if you're too internal, nothing is going to appear. And you've got to demonstrate how you're feeling more than just feeling how you're feeling. And in that sense, I went for actors who were naturally expressive and who didn't hold back.
It was hard for me to call him Snowy. For me, it's Milou. You know, I was working with my friend who's American, and I said, please help me with my lines. And I read, Tintin looks at Snowy. And I read, Snowy? I thought it was a description of the weather or something. You know, I said, look at Snowy. Well, okay, they're going to put some snow in this scene. It's going to be like special effect. So my friend said, no, Snowy is someone. He didn't know the comic book. So he said, no, I think Snowy is someone. I said, no, it's impossible. So the guy said, there's a dog in this movie. I said, yes, why? It's Snowy. Oh, no, it's Milou, please. You cannot. It's Milou.
Tintin starts off on that very first adventure with one companion, one very loyal companion, a little dog, a little white fox terrier. Fox terriers aren't normally completely white, but Snowy is an exception. Now, Hergé had come up with the name Tintin. He liked the sound of it. What would he call the dog? Well, he'd had a girlfriend, a girl who he really very much loved, and she loved him, called Marie-Louise van Cutsem, Milou for short. And so as a tribute to this great love of his great first love of his, called Tintin's first and closest companion, Milou. Unfortunately, that is lost in translation in English, where we have Snowy, which is a very nice name for a dog, but it doesn't reflect that particular love interest.
What is it, Snowy?
I think sometimes Tintin makes a great sidekick to Snowy. For the most part, Snowy is Tintin's loyal mascot and helper, but there are times where Tintin owes a great deal to the contribution Snowy makes to the adventure.
It's good to see you too. See if you can chew through these ropes.
I mean, Snowy is Tintin's faithful friend. he's his long-standing best friend in the whole world.
Thank you.
And I think in this movie, I've always tried to pay very close attention, as is Stephen and Peter, to always including Snowy. I mean, because we don't have a real dog to work with, it is sometimes very easy to forget him or leave him out. Brad Elliott, who's our props guy, who is actually, you know, really bringing Snowy to life, and we're interacting as actors. He's always behind me in a scene where I'm always telling him to do things so that Tintin and Snowy have interaction with each other. He's really worked incredibly hard. I mean, there's a lot of scenes where we're running around and he's really keeping up with me full step. He's done an absolutely incredible job. He's a puppeteer in his own right.
One of my favorite things to do on this movie, and it's a great privilege, is that I get to manipulate Snowy. It's my job on the set to make sure that there's something for Jamie Bell to interact with.
Well done, Snowy.
To have something in the volume, in the space, in that moment that's there and real, and it takes the size and shape, and they can interact with it.
We have versions of Snowy. We have the stuffy Snowy, which is a soft Snowy, so that they can jump on him and squeeze him. We have roller Snowy, so when he needs to run, he's on wheels. We have the hard Snowy, so that when he has to fall or something like that, we don't damage him. And then we just have cutout Snowy, so we have reference of Snowy everywhere.
Snowy is a character living within this world as strongly as Tintin and Haddock. But of course, he doesn't have the gift of human language. He has to evoke and emote these complex feelings and emotions towards Tintin and Haddock, and frustration with their decisions sometimes, but it's all through body language. Now, trying to bring that to the anatomical structure of a believable animal that has no ability to stretch and move the skull, widen or tighten the eyes, becomes a complex design issue. One of the tools that we used was to sculpt Snowy in 3D, and Greg Tozer did some very beautiful studies of Snowy that really helped us at an illustrative level to sort of break free a little bit and start to discover the character within Snowy. Using real dogs, of course, is always a treat too, and we had a very Snowy-like dog in our workshop for a long time that came invaluable to the process of designing. So it all made for a great fun design period.
Of course, the real character and performance of Snowy is going to be animation as opposed to motion capture, and that is the job of the animators at Weta Digital.
The animation process for Snowy was we would have a previous template and a rough idea on where the director would want Snowy in shot, and it's up to the animator to try and bring him to life and bring a performance of their own to Snowy.
My wallet! It's gone! Come on! Snowy, after it! Stop! Wait!
Once we'd shot it all, the animators would come in and further flesh out and put the real character into Snowy. And we often thought of lots of gags and lots of things which stemmed from the books, his mischievous nature. When we came to animation, we were able to really go to town on that side of things.
Snowy's obviously a great character and one that we focused on because he is so animation driven. We did some tests early on with performance capture just to make sure we understood the proper realistic motion of Snowy. But because you can't actually have a dog directed to act exactly as you need in each of the scenes, that became just a reference in the animators' minds and just something that they could have for inspiration. But then the animators would have to go in and set keyframes for all of Snowy's poses in each of the shots.
You know, any character that's got fur is always a challenge. But Snowy is so iconic and so specific that, yes, we did look at a lot of real dogs, a lot of dogs that we knew had inspired Hergé. But Snowy is a very, very specific look to the dog.
Because Snowy had very curly white fur, technically that presents a challenge because fur becomes really difficult to work with. So what we did is we created a tool for the people modeling Snowy's fur to be able to go in and just brush it. They could treat it like real fur and go in and just comb the fur and comb it into the curls that they needed. And then that would allow us to simulate the curls, doing all the proper bounce as Snowy would run around through the shop. What's interesting about Snowy is he really understands what's going on in the film, oftentimes ahead of everyone else. And you can see that a lot in his performance. He watches, he pays attention, he figures things out, and he tries to make things happen. So he's the one that actually guides us along a couple of the key moments of the journey. He's so human in that regard that he really becomes part of the storytelling.
Snowy, what have you done?
I spent a few months researching and recording dogs, trying to find the material that might become part of Snowy or might not. And then the back half of the job spent actually cutting the material together and actually putting the voice on Snowy himself. The voice for Snowy is a mixture of probably 25 different dogs, some used in, you know, very small sections, some used just for a sniff or a slurp. For the most part, it's three or four key dogs. There's Mutter, the miniature schnauzer, who does the bark and the interesting growling stuff.
A giant rat of Sumatra!
Play the authentic miniature schnauzer. And so here's the pitched down version. We basically just slow it down in pitch. So that sort of does two things. One, it makes the dog bigger and more heroic. And two, it sort of reveals a bit more of that gravelly character. Sputnik does 90% of the expressive, the question marks, the disgruntled noises, all those little, amazing little vocalizations that Snowy has to do to express that range of emotion.
And then shines forth the eagle's cross.
And then there's Zeph, who does all the sort of concerned noises, slightly worried noises, all the little vocal whines. There's a great sequence where the Rottweiler's chasing Tintin and Snowy through the woods, and Snowy makes his heroic entrance and stares down the dog and barks so loudly he barks him into submission. So I'll play a little section of that.
Well done, Snowy. Good boy.
Yeah, what a hero.
People adore Snowy. He's such a huge character, hugely important character, and you're always thinking about Snowy's journey as well.
I was terrified that Snowy gets the last word in the film. I laboured over it. I had about five or six different versions of it at one point, trying to decide exactly how much excitement I had, or it's bizarre to see so much in a buck.
It's Milou, please. You can look. It's Milou.
French conductor who recently conducted the Los Angeles Philharmonic, and he said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing a film called Tintin. What is that? I said, well, it's a little about a boy from a Belgian cartoon. He said, oh, you mean Tintin. So everything is in a vowel sound in the end. You're getting that right.
Tintin!
Tintin is a first for me. I never did anything to do with a cartoon or an animation, which I've actually always wanted to do.
This was also another first for me. We recorded the score a year and a half ago. Actually recorded the score right after Michael did his cut, and I approved the cut, and Peter Jackson saw the cut. I brought the film to John Williams, who started writing the music and was scoring the film 4 months later.
The process of making those films is something quite different. We recorded some of the music early on when the graphics were just beginning to be drawn, and what I actually hoped to try to do was in some of the action sequences to create maybe what is an old Disney technique of doing the music first and then have the animators animate to the silhouette of what the music is doing based on suggestions from a script. So I was able to do the pirate music and to do some of the music having to do with sleuths and the comedic material with the Thompsons and so on, way, way back before we had anything more than a few little sketches. For whatever unconscious or intuitive reasons, I chose to feature a euphonium, which people maybe not know, but it's a kind of a very small tuba accompanied by accordion for the Thompson's theme. Can make a kind of a silly sound, and at least in my terms of set of references, a period sound, meaning in band concerts, for example, in the 1920s, you might have heard a euphonium concerto, or even as late as the 30s.
Oh, gracious. Mrs. Estelle. Dear. You all right? Are you all right, sir?
So the score was put together in a somewhat different way. Some of the earliest scenes that I did with a very small orchestra because we did have the opening credits. Two or three versions of that thing. The present one that we have with that sort of funny jazz combination, choreographing all of his moves and so on, and other attempts which involve similar themes. And we kept coming back to this 1920s, early 1930s European jazz, and it was such fun. Well, Snowy's music is a quick dance, I guess you can say. And Snowy is a very contributive character in the piece. He can even steal some scenes if you're not very careful about it, or if you deliberately do it, he will do it very successfully. For me, he always provided a lightness and a tempo and a quickness. Chasing the cat, over the fire engine, finding his way to Karaboujan, all of this. Snowy lightens it right up for us, you know, so he reminds us that actually we're having fun with this. And Snowy contributes a lot in that way, musically, for me. He gave me a place to go to make things light. That's the essential role, musically, for me, one of contrast.
They didn't reckon on one thing. Sir Francis was a haddock, and a haddock always has a trick up his sleeve.
Well, this transgenerational experience that Haddock has is probably something we'd all like to have. We could remember what our grandfathers were doing on a certain day in June and actually feel it in the genetic swirl of things. But it was certainly fun to try to link the present Haddock with Sir Francis. Cutting back and forth is something we can actually do musically. I mean, you can hear Haddock's theme, you can hear Sir Francis's material, and actually mix them up and maybe suggest in Haddock's mind or when he's on the screen another suggestion of what Sir Francis was and what his energies were and so on. It can be a nice opportunity for music to transpose itself from one time frame to another time frame. Just musical fun for me.
Well, John's scores are never eclectic. John's scores are just the opposite. John's scores pull together a style or a tone musically. So John is the bonding agent that unifies all the disparate, eclectic elements of a movie and makes all of us who work with him so grateful for him.